unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what saith thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down with his finger, wrote on the ground, and though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest until the last. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said unto her, Woman, where are all thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Father God, we just come to you this evening, Lord. Lord, it's never too many times to be able to talk to you. And Lord, when we got things on our mind and on our heart, and Lord, you want a personal relationship, Lord, as we can just come to you about anything. And Lord, you know our hearts today. You know how heavy they are. And Lord, you know this message, Father God. For some reason, Lord, you want to share it with your people. Lord, I just pray, God, that your will be done. And Lord, just be with all the ones that's not able to be here. Be with our pastor and his family, God. Give them rest, and Lord, just help them to overcome the trials and tribulations of life itself. Lord, thank you for your grace and your mercy in Christ's name. Amen. Verse number 4. It says, They said to him, Master, this woman was taken into adultery in the very act. Now Moses, verse number 5, in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what saith thou? I'm interested in this thought. It says that such should be stoned. My thought tonight is put the rock down. Just put the rock down. Jesus went up to the Mount of Olives, and the next morning he came and started teaching. And so many times as God's people, when something goes awry in our very life or in our culture, in our politically correct society, when things don't go the way we want it, we start, first thing is throwing rocks. We like, you know, and it ain't just literal rocks that I'm talking about. I'm talking about anything that has to do to me or hurt or do whatever it does to belittle somebody. And here, the Pharisees and scribes, they wanted her to be put to death for the very act of sin. I am thankful that even though they was trying to live under the law, that we don't still live under the law. They tried to, and I'm getting ahead of myself, but they tried to get Christ to say which he would rather have. You want to be stoned or not stoned? And if he said one, he would have went against the Roman law. And if he said the other, he would went against the Mosaic law, or Moses law. So they was trying to tempt him to say which or the other. But I love how he comes about and says, hey, the one without sin in their life, let them throw the first stone, right?
Amen.
But put the rock down. Let us look at the act of picking up the rock. You know, it's so easy to look at other people's lives and justify your life or my life by what they do. That's what these people was doing. They seen, and here it was the week of festival or happy festive, and a lot of carnal activity goes on, just like here in our day and time. I mean, it happened then, it's still happening now. But it was not unusual to see crazy stuff, like, I guess you would say, like Mardi Gras, stuff like that. But they, being the religious leaders, seen this act and acted upon it. and granted what she was doing was wrong, sin is sin. But therefore, who is to dictate or give a definition of sin? You know, whose sin is greater, mine or yours? Right. Only one can do that, is our Heavenly Father. But put the rock down, it becomes an act. You have to literally put yourself in the motion of doing that very thing. The rock does not just automatically come placed in our hand. We actually have to bend over, put some type of action or a work involved. A lot of times and places, we don't want to do nothing, but we want to see it done. You understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
A lot of times we want people to be held accountable, but we don't want to be held accountable for ourselves.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
You're right. You're right.
Here tonight, they was trying to show their power. They wanted Christ to do what they wanted him to do. But they did not realize who he really was.
Right.
So tonight, I want us to look at the act, which is sin. And we all sin. We all do. You can sit there and say that you've never, or you don't sin no more. I'll be the first one to beg the difference. But I am so thankful that I've got the Redeemer. I got somebody, the Mediator, in between me and the Heavenly Father that I can go to on any given day, any given moment, any given hour to be able to sit and talk to my Heavenly Father.
Yeah. Amen.
There's sin in my life. There's sin in yours. But who has got the right to pick up the stone?
Right.
Who's got the very act? Because we all have that type of sin. Verse number 5, it says, "Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned, but what saith thou?" Here they are wanting an action. First we've seen the act, which is sin. Sin is the first thing that makes us want to do something about it. When we see somebody not acting right or not living right, or, you know, we want to be one of them people that, you know, is higher, mightier than everybody else. We want to be judge and jury. We want to try to, you know, live everybody else's life for them. We, you know, that's not the way Christians are supposed to act, this, that, and the other. You know, I am so thankful I live under grace. I really am.
Amen.
Because I'll be honest with you, I've already been stoned to death. Very, very, could have well been. But the very action, he was wanting, the scribes, the Pharisees, the religious crowd was wanting Jesus to take action against this lady. I'm so thankful that in my sinful life, before I accepted Christ as my Savior, I'm thankful even to then that Christ did not act upon my sin.
Yes.
Because, I'll be honest with you, you know, I got saved when I was 19 years old. Growing up in this church from, I guess, infant stage. But still yet, I knew about God. I knew everything, you know, not everything, but, you know, I was a good, I guess you would say, backdoor, outback Christian, whatever. You know, people expected me to be there, and I was there, and that's where they see me from, that, you know, but I never had no personal relationship. But the things that I've done, if he would have went ahead upon his judgment or against the world's standard about taking judgment on my life at the age of, say, 18 or 19, I would have never made it or been here when God called me to preach and to be able to proclaim the word of God. I'd be in a devil's hell. And so would you if God has not spared us. God gave us a space of grace. But we, as God's people, need to be able to look at our life, look at other people's lives, and not have a judgmental attitude. Because we're killing, just like America, we're killing ourselves within.
Amen.
We try to judge people and want people to be just like we are, just like I am. I'm thankful everybody's not like I am.
Amen.
I'll be honest with you. And I'm sure you probably feel the exact same way.
Me too.
If you don't, I do. I feel like I'm thankful I'm not the way a lot of y'all are.
Amen.
I'll be the first one to say that. But there is always an action that comes upon it. But see here in verse number 6, and I promise you, and I was speaking to Brother Claudia, but I know that we have snacks tonight, and I'm going to go ahead and say any of the visitors or, everybody please stay and go over and have a fellowship and everything. But I was picking at him. The pastor called me this earlier today, and I told him Pharaoh finally let us go. He sort of figured that he was due for a loan. I told him, and then I meant to tell him this evening that I wasn't going to be like him. I know that there's snacks in there. And I love Brother Buckner. One thing, if you don't know Dr. Buckner, you truly missed out on the blessing. But I've learned one thing. I don't get paid by that. I love being with God's people and just sharing what the Lord lays on my heart. And then when that's done, we'll go to the house and go eat some watermelon chicken, whatever it is over there. But verse number 5 and 6, I want to look at this real quick. Now, Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what saith thou? There again, they're tempting God. This, they said, tempting him that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. When we get to the part of acting in our life, when sin is in our life and it's always there, when people's trying to stone us or we're trying to stone us or stone other people, there's action that's involved. But then there's accusations. See, they was wanting Christ to be tempted. They wanted him to choose whether to stone or not to stone, so they could accuse him of going against one of the other laws because they was teachers of the law. They lived by the law. And what that is a picture of is being selfish. You know, as we accuse people of not being like me or you, we accuse people of maybe not dressing like you think we ought to dress or, how it ought to be or this, that, and the other. We accuse other people, and that's a selfish individual trying to get other people to be like I said a minute ago, like ourselves.
Right.
And that's what these Pharisees, they come to Christ. They knew that he had to make a choice. They did not know that they was actually speaking to God in the flesh. But there's a lot of different thoughts and theories and you might have whatever, but what he was writing on the ground. And some of the things that I found that some of them think that it was he was writing the sins of the Pharisees and scribes on the ground. And then some was saying that he was writing down the commandments on the ground. And it didn't even pay him no mind. I don't know about you, but if I'm talking to somebody and somebody just especially kids don't even pay no mind, it makes me mad. And I'm sure this infuriated these people because Jesus never even paid like he was even there. He just got back down and started. Can you imagine coming to a person and having them to make a choice what to do about this individual? And he starts, don't know you much from Adam's house, and start writing possibly your name, what you've done in your life. And you're thinking, how in the world does he know all about this? Or started writing the commandments down. And then you see that they started having convictions. And I don't know if it was so much, the Bible says convictions, but a lot of us, when we hear convictions, we think of, things in our life that we know is wrong and we are convicted and turn and go the other way. I believe that what that word here is talking about is being, ashamed. They seen that they could not cast a stone because they had sin in their life.
Yeah.
When we as God's people start throwing accusations, start making people feel like they're inferior, or they don't deserve to be beside us, they don't deserve to be in the same room, a lot of times we make people feel like, you know, they're belittled, they don't fit in, and we start throwing accusations. But we can't throw anything because we have the same problem that everybody else does.
Right.
We have a sin problem.
Yes, we
That's
do.
What's wrong with this nation.
Right.
But we got to learn to be able to put the rock down. It's so easy to pick it up. Has anyone ever been hit by a rock?
Yes,
sir. It hurts. I'll never forget. I hadn't heard this guy's name in years. And bless his heart, he passed away. Lord, he was a year or two older than me. He passed away in the 9th or 10th grade, and I had a brain tumor. But he used to go to Newham with us. And you talking about me and my cousin put that boy through it. And I think it might be somebody, I ain't going to tell you his name. I think it might actually be somebody here related to him. But we used to skip rocks. He'd be across the river from us. We'd skip rocks and just see if we could, and actually we did every now and then hit him. But he didn't enjoy that too much. But if you've ever been hit by a rock, it hurts. Physically it hurts. But if you've ever been hit by an emotional stone or a boulder or whatever, you know, it hurts.
Yes, it hurts.
A lot of times it's hard to dig your way out from underneath that. I wish I was like the coyote in the Roadrunner whenever the rock, you know, just basically just switch your way out and pop back up, everything's fine. But it don't work that way. You know, when we go through things like this in our life, when we either we make accusations or other people make selfish accusations against us, the first and foremost thing we're doing, we're throwing rocks at people. Like I said earlier, you know, by the law, most of us in here would probably all been stoned to death.
Yeah.
More than likely. By the law, we would all probably been stoned to death if we were still under the law. But we looked at the act, which is a sin, the action, which is stoned, the accusation, we all want to accuse people, which is a selfishness. But they finally got, in verse number 7, they got their answer. So when they continued asking him, he lifted himself up and said unto them, he that is without sin and among you, let him first cast a stone at her. So they did not hear what they wanted to hear. And most of us don't want to hear what God wants us to hear. We want to hear what we want to hear.
Right.
And then it says in verse number 8, and again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. You know, I could imagine that was a somber walk. It was more like, you know, a defeated walk. They lost the battle. They could not trick him into, you know, being tempted and falling, and they'd be able to arrest him under false accusations. But there was an answer that was given. He that was without sin. You can stone her all you want, but you better not have no sin in her life. But I seen this at the end. It says, and Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. You know, after everybody left, there was only one person with her that had the authority and the right to stone her. Because he did not have no sin. But still yet, here comes grace. When Jesus had lifted up himself and saw none but the woman, he said to her, woman, where are those thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, no man, Lord. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. I'm thankful that even when we are in his midst, he still has nothing but love for me. When you get into the presence of God, think about this. This woman was accused of one of the heinous sins back in that day, and still looked frowned upon, should be anyway. But she was probably close, as most of y'all are sitting, with our Lord and Savior. I mean, that does something to me, because that means that He still loves sinners. And I am thankful for that.
Yes, sir.
I mean, because the religious crowd, and even to today, people don't want to be around people that aren't the way they are.
Yeah.
They don't like, and I don't see going into bars trying to, you know, witness to people, because, you know, it's sort of going to be hard to witness to somebody that's probably 3/4 drunk on the bar stool. You know, try to get them before they go in there. And don't try to get them when they come out either. But we, as God's people, we need to first and foremost put our rocks down. We don't need to be casting stones at each other, at, you know, what. And there's so much division going on, not between, you know, Christians or in the house of God, but in this nation, I've never seen it so divided, ever.
Amen, brother.
And,
amen.
You know, this is, I mean, just, it just blows my mind how people look and just don't have no pride. No pride at all. I mean, there's people to this day, right now, as we speak, probably giving their life for me and you. Other than Jesus Christ, the next person that's laying down their life for brother. I know the cops, they do, but they are fighting a war. These cops could go out daily, they're trying to protect us.
Right.
I mean, I could not disrespect people like that. Even, I'll never forget this, and this is what America should really mean. I don't know how many of you watched the Olympics, and I didn't watch none of it. The only thing I've seen was, if I can pronounce his name right, Usain Bolt. He's one of the fastest runners. Most of you, if you've ever seen anything, you know he's from Jamaica. And he was being interviewed. And this was this year Olympics in wherever it was at, Rio or whatever. She was interviewing her. It was our people over there interviewing her. Our national anthem, come on. He hushed her. Turned around, put his hand over his heart, made her do the same thing.
Amen.
Amen.
And sit there, and then waited, I mean, until the national anthem was done, then he went back into the state that he was, you know, working with at that time. That done something for me. And we got people that just walk across the flat. Don't have, and I know that this ain't nothing what I was sharing, but yeah, I don't know. It bothers me. It really, really does. And it's going to filter from that high of a stage. It's going to filter, as you've seen a lot of this other mess, it's going to be into our high schools.
Yep.
It's going to be into, I mean, every aspect of our kids' life is going to be taken completely away from their heritage, their pride, and what this country stands for. This country stands for God first, and then the American people that has given their life. So me and you can do, have the freedom,
yeah,
to be able to worship. I mean, going to Walmart or going on a vacation, yeah, that's nice to be able to do that. But we don't understand how much of a blessing it is to be able to worship freely.
Amen.
I mean, it's going to come a point, if the Lord tarries his coming, it's going to be a point, probably, the way that, I mean, I would never thought I'd probably see it if I lived to even be a ripe old man. I didn't probably think I'd ever see it, unless, you know, but the way this country's turned around in the last 3 or 4 years, I mean, we might see it within 5 years if Christ will come back.
Right.
I mean, it's under siege, it's bad.
Right.
And we definitely need to pray for our country. Pray for our military. I don't know about you, but if I was on foreign soil right now, fighting for our country, and seeing that they don't, the national anthem, what I'm over there doing, don't mean nothing to these people. You talking about boiling my blood, I mean, I'd be...
Right.
That would hurt deep.
Yes, it would.
That'd cut very deep. People don't realize the consequence of their actions. They don't have a clue.
Everybody.
Just like most people, and I'm not getting into politics and everything else, but most, I read that 44 people of protesters was arrested. 42 of them wasn't even from this state.
You're right.
So right there tells you, this ain't about right here local. It's about the government trying to control us.
Amen.
And they're doing a very good job so far. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, God, we just come to you tonight. God, with heavy hearts, and Lord, I just pray, God, that just a little thought that I brought to you tonight, to your people, God, that would open up hearts and minds and let us realize how truly blessed we are. And Lord, don't take other people for granted. And Lord, be careful how we throw our stones, because it's going to come back on us. And Lord, I just ask God to bless the food that's over there, the ones that's prepared it. And God, be with our pastor again. Lord, just give them rest and relaxation. And Lord, just be with our country. Be with the men and women that's overseas or even here home abroad that's fighting for our freedom. I want to thank you for it. And I just want to thank you for your blessings on us. Thank you for these dear people that's here tonight. I just want to thank you and praise you in Christ's name. Amen and amen.